I want to get down on my knees and I want to pray. Now, the first miracle you're going to see is me getting up. After that, we're going to go into the word of the Lord. But you stand to your feet. Come on, let's go before the Lord. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. How good it is to be in the house of the Lord. We haven't come to hear from a man. We haven't come to hear from a tall man, short man, old man, young man. No, nope, we're not going to do that. We haven't come to hear from a woman. We haven't come to hear from a black man, brown man. We haven't come to hear from anybody, Lord, except the teacher of the church, who is the Holy Spirit. So welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us and motivate us to be all that you would have us to be. And Lord, 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 we'll give you the praise and glory and all the honor. Don't just bless us today. Bless all the churches that are gathering in your name around the planet. Our denominational brothers, our non-denominational brothers, our charismatic Pentecostal brothers, whomever they may be that are gathering in your name and they're sharing your word, bless them also as you would bless us. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. With a great big shout, we all say amen. I want to take you to Hebrews, the 11th chapter. This is our third time in this little verse, of verse number 30. In verse 30 of the 11th chapter, it talks about the walls of Jericho. And if you remember those, they're brilliant messages that were brought by Pastor Dan and Pastor Luke about the walls of Jericho that were literally life-changing. And if you didn't get those, you ought to get them because they're absolutely amazing. I'm going to read the verse to you real quick, and then I want to share something with you that oftentimes we don't see in Scripture. We take the Scripture, we don't realize there's more to Scripture than just the writing, the black and white letters that are on a page. For an example, you know, you can get the word that's on that page, but never get the character, nature, and attributes of God. In order for you to understand the word of God, you're going to have to take the word and then mix it, if you will, with the character, nature, and attributes of God to come up with what it is that God is truly saying. And sometimes we never go past the natural into the supernatural of what God's saying. May I say it like this? God oftentimes says more by not saying anything. And as we look at the word of the Lord today, this little verse just pops out and says something great. Could you just pop it up on the overhead for us? And here's what verse 30 says. It says, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were encircled for 7 days. We all probably know the story by now. But if you don't know the story, it's a crazy little story. Here are the children of Israel. Let me just refresh it. If you want to read more about it, you can read more about it in Joshua, the 6th chapter. Starting in verse number 1 through verse number 20, but I'm not going to go there. I thought I was going to read it to you and all that stuff. Do it on your own. Let me just talk about it just for a moment. Here we see something that you need to see. We see that God's children are coming out of bondage with Egypt. They've been there for 400 years. They are conditioned to live as slaves. May I say that to you? And then all of a sudden, here comes Moses, and he leads them out of bondage into what is called the Promised Land. And God could have taken them into the Promised Land in about a week's worth of walking. But he doesn't. Before they get to the Promised Land, he's going to take them to a place called the wilderness. Interesting. Why doesn't he take them to the Promised Land? Why does he take them to the wilderness? Because there's something these people have got to learn. And it's the same thing we have to learn to this day. They have to learn how to take directions from God all over again. Because they've been in bondage for so long and made up their own minds on how to exist and how to plant crops and how to grow food and how to eat and how to provide and how to make life work under the Egyptian bondage, that when they came in to the place where they were free, God takes them into a wilderness area where they had to trust God to survive. The problem with it is they did not trust God. They trusted in their own senses, their own abilities, their own calculations, their own gathering of data, and coming up with a formula on how to live. And we do the same thing today. It's all about what we think and how we calculate things and how we feel about stuff and what society has taught us over the years and what people have taught us and what we have learned so we can come up with our own ideas on how life works. And then we ask God to get involved in what we think instead of us getting involved in what He says. And we wonder why we just bump along as Christians all of our lives. So important for us to see this, and that's exactly what happens to the children of Israel. This generation goes into the wilderness, and while they're there in the wilderness, they start to complain about everything. They complain about the food. They complain about not having the food. They complain about the type of food, too much of that kind of food. God drops food from heaven. They're complaining about that. God brings the quail in from the mountains, and they come into the camp and they complain about that. They complain about everything because they have their own, listen to this, you got to get this. They have their own ways of thinking that's more important than God's ways of thinking. So God comes along. And now that whole entire, for 40 years, that generation, because they were so stuck in themselves and their own thinking, calculations, ideologies, and philosophies on how to do life, instead of listening to the voice of the Lord, they were so stuck, that entire generation had to die off so the next generation could be properly trained to do something. Listen to the directions of God instead of your own ideas, which sounds so simple, but it is so difficult. The next generation is where you see them coming with the leader Joshua into this promised land before they do. And as they do, they come in, and the first problem they come across is a massive problem. It's a city. It's a fortified, impregnable city. The walls are so thick that people live in the walls. Chariots run around the top of them. No one has ever been able to penetrate into this city. Man, it is closed up tight. They know the children of Israel are coming, and they are petrified. And God gives the children of Israel an assignment that is crazy. Absolutely crazy. March around 6 days with your trumpeters and your priest out in front. Don't say a word. Don't mumble a word. Don't speak a word. Shut up. For 6 days you walk around, one day at a time. On the seventh day you circle this building seven times. And then you circle it again. Seven times your trumpeters blow their trumpets, the priests blow their horns, and then everybody hears that, and I want you to shout a great shout, and the walls will come tumbling down, and all the people that are in that city, and by the way, archaeologists have dug up remnants of people, their estimate is there was like 50,000 people that were completely flattened. Here's my question to all of us that are thinkers, at least in this place today. Why in the world does God request of us crazy things like that? Why doesn't He just annihilate the city? Why didn't He just open up the ground and swallow it up for these people that are going in the promised land? He's done that before. Why doesn't He just cause a great earthquake to crumble it? Why doesn't He just send a star out of the sky to hit it like a nuclear weapon and bang, the city's gone? Instead, all through the Bible, there are bizarre I want you to hear this, so I'm going to say it again. All through the Bible, there are bizarre, one more time, I want you to get this. All through the Bible, there are bizarre directions to God's people from Genesis to Revelation. Example, Gideon. This guy's not bothering anybody. He's running for his life. He gathers 300 men to come against a Syrian army of hundreds of thousands. He says, light your torches, blow your horns, and all of a sudden, who does that? And he wins the battle. How about this one? How about when the children of Israel were confronted by hundreds of thousands of trained soldiers and they were going to get slaughtered, and God says to them, here's what I want you to do. I want you to take your praisers and your singers, and I want you to put them out in front and praise the Lord. Is that a nutty request? How about David, a little kid off the hills of Judea, literally, with a slingshot facing a murdering machine called Goliath? Nuts! God, why is it you sometimes, because God, you got to hear this. God wants to show you that in the bizarre requests, God comes through. So that when he requests something that's not bizarre from you, he'll come through surely for you. And we miss this all the time. We miss this all the time because we fail to get directions from God. Can you imagine what life would be like if you got directions from God? You would never make a marital problem and choice that's wrong. Your finances would be an abundant place. If you got directions from God, your children would be serving the Lord in a mighty way. Everything would work just right if you just simply got directions from God. That directions that God wants to give us oftentimes is stopped. Hindered, completely stopped by our own personal thinking, agenda, wants, and will. And you say, God, I want God to give me directions. What's the problem? The problem is you and me. We don't think like that. So God puts these crazy stories in the Bible to show us that, man, if we follow him in the things that he says to us day to day, we can get directions from him that are great, mighty, and marvelous. That would change our entire life, change our entire destiny, change our entire purpose, touch people's lives for hundreds of years because God walked with you and you heard his directions and you followed. You say, well, how did I fail at all of this? How come mankind doesn't hear and get the directions from God? You've got to understand, it goes all the way back to Genesis, the second chapter, right off the bat. God says to Adam, he didn't even say it to Eve, she wasn't even created from his side yet. He says to Adam, all the trees in the garden you can eat of. But the one tree here that I want to point out to you, don't partake of that tree. And here's the reason why. Because when you partake of this tree, you will surely die. So he has this one tree. It's the tree of, listen to what the tree is. Knowledge of good and of evil. And he says, if you partake of the tree of knowledge and of good and of evil, then all of a sudden you're going to be able to decide for yourself based on your thinking what is good and evil, what is right and wrong. And now we've come to a place in our society where right is wrong, wrong is right. We can't figure out anything. Is anybody there besides me? We got a bunch of politicians running. I don't think any of them have any brains at all. They may have a lot of money, but I'm telling you, I'm not excited about voting for anybody. I'd much rather go to Disneyland and vote for Mickey Mouse than vote for somebody that they're running. Why? Because right is wrong, wrong is right. Why? Because we were at that time when he and she partook of that fruit, they died spiritually because now they were no longer taking their direction from God. They now could make the directions for themselves. And for thousands of years, we humans have been screwing it all up. Is anybody listening? So here comes Jesus Christ, washes us with his blood, brings us back to a garden relationship with God, where now we have the ability to get directions from God, but we're going to have to do something inside of us. We're going to have to do some things. I'll share with you what they are. I was reading last week, I think it was, about a real special American that made me really happy that I'm an American. I have a hard time with this, so forgive me. She made me proud to be a Christian. Her name is Harriet Tubman. I'm going to show you her picture. A lot of you don't know who she is. Many of you do know. She's replacing Andrew Jackson on the $20 bill, and rightfully so. Let me tell you why it's so important that I tell you this story. In the early 1800s, she was born as a slave. As she got a little bit older, she escaped into a free state. Instead of thinking about herself, she talked to God about getting others out of slavery and bringing them free. And she told God in her own way that, God, I'll do what you want me to do. And God directed her. And over the years, she delivered from slavery hundreds of slaves. It's such an interesting story because the slavers hated her guts. And they put a $40,000 bounty on anybody that would capture Harriet. $40,000, my friend, may not seem like much to you today, but in the early 1800s, that's like $10 million. If somebody put a $10 million bounty on me, I wouldn't get out of this building today. And they were trying with everything they could to catch her, but they couldn't catch her. They had traps set for her. They followed her. They had dogs chasing her. They sniffed her out, everything, but they couldn't catch her. In fact, the one statement they said when they got back these slavers, as they gathered together in their anger after losing the slaves, they would say, "We're so mad. It's like we had her, and then the road went underground." And that's where the terminology Underground Railroad came from. She was called Black Moses, because she led so many hundreds out of slavery. All that's good, and I thought that was great, and that was certainly worthy to me to be on the $20 bill. But what the next part was that I read that blew me away is a man wrote, and he wrote these words: "Doesn't matter what color I've known over the years, I've never known anybody that so clearly heard from God in every area of her life. So clearly heard that when she was being chased, God said, 'Don't go that way, go this way. Stop right here, let them go.'" And God told her time and time again, God gave her directions. If God can give Harriet directions to do life, how much more can God give you and God give me if we would just be a people who realize I can't make decisions on my own. I need him to give me the directions for the future. Is anybody listening? I want to share with you some things, if I may, four things that are, I think are really good for all of us to look at. Four things about what it's going to take. And I love this. Did I give you the title of the message? I don't know if I did or not. The title of the message, I forgot what it was, so just put it up. That's the title, Receiving Direction from God. And it's a great title, but I want to know how to receive direction from God. And God gave me four things. I believe God could have given me 400 things, and I'm writing about most of them right now, but these four things are vitally important for you and I to understand. So may I communicate them with you for a moment? Do I still have your attention at all?
Yes.
You understand what I'm saying is that God desperately wants to talk to you, but he doesn't want to talk to somebody who doesn't listen. May I say this? When you don't listen, God stops talking. I've learned that over the years. And then we say, I wonder if it's God. I wonder why God doesn't do this. I wonder why it isn't working. It's so important for us to see, number one, on how to receive directions from God. Number one. And it's all about the heart. May I say this about you and your relationship with God? A lot of people think it's about what you do or don't do, and that has a lot to do with it. But what you do and don't do has to be done because there's a heart behind it. And I'm not talking about that which just simply beats, you know, like in your chest, boom, 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 boom. I'm talking about your whole makeup that has a passion for something. It has an insight to something, a desire for something. And it's the whole makeup of man called the heart. And it's really all about the heart. And so number one is it's a committed heart to God. Because you're not going anywhere, and you're not going to ever listen to God, and you're not going to ever believe God, and you're not going to do anything with God if you don't have this incredible commitment to God. You have to know that when I talk about Harriet Tubman, that she was literally a lady who was dependent on God for her very existence. And you will find that as you're walking around the walls of Jericho, that those people had to be dependent upon God, and that every person was asked by God to do something that was contrary to their thinking. You got to get that again. Every person in the Bible that was asked by God to do something that was contrary to their thinking, contrary to their feelings, contrary to their plans, contrary to their will. Every person has got to come to a place of realizing that my commitment to God is more than anything else. And it starts by just simply being born again. Nothing works. Some of you in here today think you have a relationship with God because you came to church today. It's not true. Some of you think you're Christians because your mom and dad told you you're Christians. Some of you think you're Christians because you know a few scriptures, celebrate Easter or Christmas. It's not true. Somebody needs to love you enough to tell you the truth. And just like anything, everything with God starts with salvation, where you become his child and he takes care of you as a parent that cares about you. Don't equate him with the parent that you had that didn't care about you. You've got to see him as a parent who does really care. Where your parent may have failed, he will never fail you. And that's where we come into this relationship of commitment of the heart. We'll talk about that before you leave today in a greater way. But we're talking about how to receive direction from God. Second thing that I found fascinating is that you're going to have to not only have a commitment to heart, you're going to have a willing heart. Listen to what I'm going to say to you for a moment. This is really hard. A willing heart is one that doesn't just hear what God says, but does what God says. Because what good is it if you hear directions from God and you don't do them? And I wonder how many of us that have been here, including me myself, have been in a place where I've heard from God numerous times about something and I just didn't do it. And God, like I said earlier, just stopped talking to me about it. Let me do my own thing. And found myself in a place of being frustrated because my own thing didn't live up to the directions that God wanted me to do. You see, a willing heart not only takes directions, but it wants to do something. It wants desperately to follow those directions. And sometimes it means you're going to have to stop where you're at, back up, go backwards, and get to the place where God spoke to you about something. Yesterday, I used this illustration. I hadn't planned on using it. I never thought of it for a second. But as I was ministering yesterday on this subject, it just came out of me. And I you're my family, so I'm going to share it with you. So I started to approach retirement. I didn't want to retire. I mean, I still feel pretty good. I'm in my 70s, but I still feel pretty darn good. And I'm finally getting a hold of what God says. You know, I'm starting to learn about something. I didn't want to give it up. But I knew that God, when he spoke to me, he says, if you love the church and you love my people, you've got to get out of the way for the next generation to come. And oh, thank God, I've seen the next generation and tasted of what God has. And I'm telling you, get ready for a ride in history. This place is amazing with Pastor Dan and Pastor Luke. But I didn't want to do that, so I thought of myself, maybe I'll do something I've always wanted to do, is be a businessman. But I hadn't got the word from God to be a businessman. I just kind of like wanted to do it. It was back to that knowledge of tree of good and evil. I'm now making decisions for myself. And I thought, well, I prayed for that when I was young. That way I can make a lot of money and I can fund the gospel. I'll just give it away and help churches and help people. And I'll just do all that stuff. And I started this business. And as I started this business, I kept saying to the people that were working with me, I have not heard from God to do this business. And I tried to hear from God, but things were coming at me, and business was coming at me, but I had not heard from God to do this business. And I kept telling them every time we had a meeting, I'm telling you guys something, I'm willing to go ahead and get started, but I have not heard from God, and if I haven't heard from God, I'm not going to do it. And in about a 6 month period of time, I made between $600,000 and $650,000 clear. I know most of you would say, man, you didn't need to hear from God. That was God. But it wasn't God. It wasn't God at all. I had just taken the skills that God had given me and the insight God had given me and recognized some things, but I had not gotten direction from God. I need direction from God. And finally, after months and months and months of not getting direction from God and making $600,000 to $650,000, God spoke to me and said, give it back to the people. Not you people, the people that I did the work for. And I gave it back, all of it, back to, because God had spoken and I knew his voice enough to know that I had directions that were contrary to my feelings and I needed to obey and deny myself of those feelings and get into a place where I'm following him. And I gave it back to the people we built for and it was a done deal, over with. At first, I started negotiating with God, could I give him half back? Are you sure this is you talking to me, God? Or is it Satan? Because it was a crazy thing to do. But I had to learn that if I'm going to hear directions from God, I've got to deny oftentimes what I want and what I feel and what I think. Is anybody listening? And giving it back was a lesson that I said to God, God, I want what you have more than what I have. And I gave it back. The Bible says this in this particular point number two, a willing heart, willing to do. And it's a wonderful verse. If you'll go with there with me in Matthew, let's take a look at it together in the 16th chapter, if you got your Bibles. In Matthew, we see Jesus talking. And as he's talking, he makes a statement to his disciples. And he's making this statement to these guys that are following him already. But he says this for your purpose and my purpose. In verse number 24, and Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself. If I'm really a person that's going to go after God, I'm going to have to get out of who I am and get into who he is. Because he's a whole lot greater than me. I can only in my own natural mind go so far. In my own natural ability go so far. In my own natural talents or gifting go so far. But when I take my talent and gifting and I put it in, he comes along and he puts in the super. Now we have what? Supernatural. And I want the supernatural in my future more than the natural in my future. So he says, deny himself, take up his cross. And tell you guys, when you give $600,000 back that you earned and nobody's complaining about giving it to you, that is a cross. Somebody got to give me a better amen than that. That was a cross. But I, with pleasure, did it. Because I'm saying something to God. God, I desire your direction more than the things this world has to offer. And I had to deny myself, pick up my cross, and do what? Follow him. And guess what? Now he's got me doing something I can't do, I don't want to do, I don't like doing, and it's boring me out of my mind, and I hate it, but I know it's God. Okay, number three, we're talking about in this wonderful subject on how to receive directions from God. Number one, if you remember, you got to have that committed heart. Number two, you're going to have a willing heart, willing to do what he says. And number three, I love this, you're going to have a focused heart. Focus means nothing from the outside stopped you from doing what you heard from God. There's none of this procrastination life that we live. If we live in a world of procrastination, that's probably not as good as you think it is in relationship with God. A focused life says, you know, I heard God, and I know there's all kinds of things that come into your life. You know, you got to stop, you got to eat, you got family, you got things, you got friends, you got time off, you got stuff like that. And I'm not saying that you stop all that just to fulfill what God gave you directions about. I'm saying you live life, but boy, don't forget about what your commitment is to what he has directed you to do. Because can you imagine that? I mean, if I was one of those children of Israel marching around the walls of Jericho, I would probably say, you know, there's a lot of distractions here. And one of the words that God gave those people is shut up when you walk around. And after a few days, don't you know the people on top of the wall are yelling? They've gathered rocks, bags of probably poop, and are going to throw them down on us as we walk around quietly. And don't you know when you get hit with a rock, that distraction is going to keep you from doing what God said to do. Shut up. They had to keep their mouth quiet. That's why God had them keep quiet, because they're always grumbling, complaining. But I think there was a lot of temptation to yell back, scream back, taunt back, say things back, do things. See, a lot of distractions in our life. The other day, I was writing at my computer for a number of hours. Sometimes I just sit back and look out at the front lawn. And it was interesting because I saw this beautiful flower. I was staring at it. And all of a sudden, the flower started moving like this. And I went, there's no wind. What's going on? And I looked at the flower again, and I thought, man, have I got some like Superman power that when I look at this flower, it moves? Man, take me to the dice table of Las Vegas. You know, that's how stupid our thinking sometimes gets, you know? So anyway, stupid pastor is sitting there watching this flower move like this. And I stopped, and it stopped, and I went back to my writing. I look out again, the flower's moving again. I went, oh my goodness, what's going on? And then the flower went, I thought to myself, that's a gopher. It ate my flowers in the front yard. Well, it wasn't a gopher, it was a mole. So I figure I'm going to go get him. Now remember, I've got direction from God to do something. I'm in the middle of a sentence from God. I'm hearing the voice of the Lord and I'm writing. There will always be distractions to what God tells you to do. So I go in and Deborah's not there, thank God, because she wouldn't let me do this. I'd do it anyway. And I got my gun. Yeah, I'm man. I got a gun, a couple of them, in fact. Come around my house, I'll shoot you and then pray for you afterwards. And I know that is so not, you know, sociably acceptable, but I really don't give a flip at my age, you know what I'm saying? And so anyway, so I go get this rifle, you know, I have this little rifle, and it'll shoot a 22 caliber bullet. So I told her I got shorts. Little shorts are like. I mean, it's like nobody's going to get it. So I go out in the front lawn, and I'm standing there, and I got this thing, and I'm standing there for like 5 minutes. And all of a sudden, I think to myself, the neighbors are going to call the police on you. And you know, nowadays, when a cop shows up and you got a gun in your hand, you're dead. We'll talk about that some other day, but you're dead. You know, and I'm old, but I'm not ready to die like that yet. You know what I mean? So I got this gun in my hand. I'm like this. And then I realize if he shows his head, I'm going to have to cock it and move it up. So I cocked it. And I moved it up right to that hole. And I'm standing there for 10 minutes. And finally, I hear from the Holy Spirit says, you are wasting a lot of time. What a distraction. And I want you to use this on Sunday. So I dropped my gun real quick. And God said, call Federico Martinez, my gardener. He was the best. And he came out, put a sit trap. And in 1 hour, he got that mole. There's all kinds of things that'll waste your time. And that's what this is all about. In 2 Timothy, it's kind of an interesting little verse. He makes this statement, you know, in 2 Timothy, 2nd chapter. Go there, pop it up for us. Let's just put it up because we're running out of time. And it says, you therefore must endure hardship. Boy, that little mole was a hardship to me. In the midst of hearing direction from God, I'm going to tell you something. Don't let any gopher get to you. He says, as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. And then next verse, it says this. And no one engaged in warfare. And may I say something? When you've heard direction from God, every demon in hell is going to try to stop you from doing it. You're in a warfare. He says, and no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this earth. And we do that all the time. God's given us direction. We got this excuse, that excuse, that excuse, not to do the directions. We have entangled ourselves in the affairs of this life that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. So we're talking about how, is that right? How to receive directions from God. Very important because he wants to give you directions. Number one, you got to be someone who's committed. Number two, you got to be willing. That means you're going to finish what he says to you. Number three, You're going to have to be somebody who's going to endure, or if you remember, focused, a heart that's focused on this. This is a hurt from God. It's a serious thing. God wants me to go there. Even though it may not be fun now, just like, can I just say, Harriet, it couldn't have been fun for her while she was doing it. It had to be a petrifying experience with people trying to kill her. And she went time and time and time again. It's not always fun, but she never knew that 200 years later, she is an American hero and a Christian hero. I can hardly wait to see her in heaven. I'm here to give her a big hug. That's what she's going to get. And I'm here to tell you guys something. You never know what God wants to do in your future if you'll just take directions from God. The fourth and last one, it's got to be a heart that is faith-filled. Faith-filled is such a cool word. It means that you believe God, that it's not believing about God, it's believing in God. It's not faith-filled means I'm not believing in what somebody else did. I don't believe in what Abraham did. I remember as a young Christian, we were trying to find a building. We were growing. I was a dumb pastor, young pastor. And we all went, do you remember this, Mama? We all went and we marched around these buildings. We'd find buildings and then we said, let's do the Jericho March, yay. We'll march around the building 7 times and we'll sprinkle it with oil just in case that doesn't get it. And we'll pray over it and we'll lay hands on the building. Can I just make one statement to you? Thank God we never got those buildings. We would have never fit in those buildings. God had a different plan, and the plan actually was almost torturous, building this building. But look today, as we're on the verge of paying it off with people's lives being changed. Oh, come on, somebody. So God has this incredible future for us in the silly things that he requests of us. A faith-filled heart does that. In fact, I love what it says. You find this in the wonderful scriptures, if you will, in Matthew. Just pop it up, if you will, this verse. Jesus is talking to a centurion. The centurion wants Jesus to heal his servant. He's dying. Jesus says to the centurion, I'll come to your house. The centurion says, no, stop, wait a minute. You don't have to come to my house. I understand authority. I'm a man under authority. You speak. And everything that's under your authority operates. Therefore, just speak and my servant will be healed. And Jesus like marvels at this guy. He's just stunned. And he says to the centurion, I've not found faith like this anywhere. We need to be people that have that kind of faith that when God said and gave us direction, man, there's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. That's the way it is. I don't know what the outcome is. I just know it's gonna be good, because God is getting involved in it. Now watch this. And Jesus says to the centurion, go your way. As you have believed, so let it be done for you. And his servant was healed that same hour. Guys, 4 things this morning that you need to know about God wanting to give you direction. And what would your life be like if you took the direction? Number one, you got to be saved. And we'll take care of that right now in a moment. Number two, you got to have a heart that is willing. Willing means, man, I'm going to do this, what God said. Number three, you got to have a heart that is focused and not letting distractions. I'm fighting distractions. Number four, you got to have a faith-filled heart. Believe in him. If God spoke today, come on, give the Lord a good praise. Because he's the one that spoke. So let's take care of number one. Some of you that are in here, I don't want anybody to move. You guys that are getting up, go ahead, get up, get out. Hurry up. The rest of you stay put for a moment. I'll let you go in a moment. I'm not trying to be mean, but I don't want to. The Holy Spirit moves, and you know, we're so rude in churches that we just get up and leave. A lot of the people that get up and leave are the people that need to hear what's going to happen next. Some of them work in our tents and things, and they leave early from the leave early section. And we thank them for their faithfulness. So is everybody steady? Let's talk. You don't go to heaven because you're a nice person. It's not in the Bible. You don't go to heaven or right with God because your mom and dad told you. It's not in the Bible. You don't get to heaven because someone says you took you to catechism class or Sunday school class as a child. You're not going to make it. You don't get to heaven because you sang in the choir at some church or took care of the pastor, counted the offering. No, you can't make it that way. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now listen, he's giving you a direction. And no man goes to the Father except by me. You can't get there your way, my way, some well-meaning church committee way, or any other way but Jesus' way. That's why he came. There's a lot of counterfeits out there, but if you stop thinking about counterfeits, can I tell you about counterfeits? There cannot be a counterfeit unless there's a real. I couldn't counterfeit a $3 bill because there's no such thing as a $3 bill. So you have to have a real, but I could counterfeit a dollar bill or a $5 or $10. There's a lot of counterfeits out there, but here's the truth. The truth is what the Bible says, what God says, he's trying to tell you something. He's the only way. And then he comes along and he tells all of us, because he loves us so much, he wants us to get to heaven, and while you're on your way to heaven, he wants to speak directions in your life and help you get blessed in every area. He tells you this. He says in John 3rd chapter, how to get to heaven, you must be born again. And I realize that when I use the word born again, people get frustrated in American churches. They don't like that. And the reason for that is because Hollywood and movies and television shows and things such as that and books have made born again people look like and act like idiots and fools. But that's not what I'm talking about. Born again means this. From the beginning of the Bible, I'm going to tell you what it means. Now listen. And from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it means this, that you have given God all of your heart and given God all of your life. That's what he's after. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Bottom line, my friends, that's the way it is. All or nothing. Isn't that a wild thing to say? God forgive us, in American church, for 250 years we have watered that down. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. And some of you need to hear this, because if you want direction from God, that'll bless your life down the road. Oh my goodness. It's going to take a commitment on your part of giving God all your heart and all your life. And that's what born again means. I'll prove it to you. Last book in the Bible, the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking. He says, I'm coming again. Now, I don't know, maybe he's coming tonight. Who knows? Maybe he's coming tomorrow. I don't know the day or the hour or time. No man does. Anybody that says he does, they're off the wall. No man does. But listen to what Jesus said. He says these words. He says, I'm coming again. And when I come, he says, I better find you hot or cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Oh, my goodness. What a rude, crude statement from the mouth of Jesus, who loves us so much. Yep, he loves you enough to say it like it is, always has. Say it like it is. He says these words, if you're lukewarm, you're not going to make it. I'll vomit you from the mouth. What's lukewarm? So we all understand. Check it out. Little in, little out, little up, little down. Token prayer, occasional church attendance. You know who Jesus is. And you think that's going to get you to heaven. But can I just say this to you, lukewarm? The devil knows who Jesus is, and he's not getting to heaven. You celebrate Christmas, but you don't care about anything else during the week except throwing up token prayer, occasional church attendance. That's lukewarm. God is something in your life. Watch this, watch this, watch it. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. He's just something. Can I tell you something? He won't give you a direction. It starts with this direction. If you can't handle this direction, you'll never get the rest of them for the rest of your life. And this is the first direction that you are going to be born again, giving him all of your heart, giving him all of your life. And you got to give it to him. He's not a thief to rob it from you. He's not a conniver. You go to church, listen to me, every day of your life, and when the pastor's not looking, you can put on every ecclesiastical robe he has and sit on the front row for the rest of your life, die and go to hell, because that's not how you get to heaven. How you get to heaven is by giving God all of your heart and all of your life. And if you haven't given God all of your heart, and if you haven't given God all of your life, I'm going to tell you that's the source of your problem, number one. And number two, here's how you get direction from God. Listen and give him your heart and life. He won't steal it from you. He's not a thief. It's yours. He's not a conniver to talk you out of it or a manipulator to make you do it. He could hit you in the head with a 2x4 spiritually all the time until you give him your heart and life, but he doesn't do that. He leaves it up to you to make a free will choice, because from the knowledge of the tree of good and of evil, you make the choice from there to give your heart to Jesus. That's what this is all about. And that sets you apart from everybody else. And today, here we are in the safe, friendly place. We've laughed, we've clapped, we've sung. And I want you blessed. I don't care about anything else but you. I care about you. You're going to have to give of yourself. You're going to have to deny your feelings. In a moment, you say, Pastor Jim, how am I going to give God all my heart? How am I going to give God all my life? In a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go like this. One, two, three, and I'll go bang. When I pop my hands together, bang, your hand goes up. As I see your hand go up, then you can put it right back down. What you're saying by the raising of your hand is, I'm giving God all my heart. I'm giving God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, and denying my presence in hell. I want that. I want God to give me direction for the rest of my life, because I know God knows best for what I have ahead of me. And it starts with you giving God all of your heart and all of your life. So here we are in a safe, friendly place. You say, wait a minute, if you want me to raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yep, you might be. Get over it. It's better to be embarrassed for a moment than to be in hell forever and ever and ever, because you care more about what people think instead of what God sees. That's insanity. It's more important that God see you make the commitment than what people think about you. So I don't care about your neighbor. It's your time right now in the name of Jesus. Today is your day of salvation. Today, God's calling you home. Today is the day that you give him all of your heart and give him all of your life. I'm going to count to three. As I do, it's your call. Who should raise her hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your life, get ready to put your hand up. If you're one of those people that are in here and you're not sure, my goodness, make sure. And don't let anything disturb you. That was just a ploy to get you off track with God so you won't do what he wants you to do. Don't be distracted from his directions. I'm counting to three. I've done my job. I've loved you enough to tell you the truth. Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Let me see your hands over here. 13. Thank you. 14. Thank you. 15. Thank you. Get them up so I can see them. 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. Back over here. Anybody else? Any back in that section? 22? I didn't see any back there. Over on this side, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26. Back over here. Anybody else? Real quick. Anybody else? Two more. 26, 27. Thank you. Got them. Anybody else? Anybody else? Where's 28? You're sitting there saying, I wonder if I should. You should. Some of you are saying, I wish that old man would just shut up. Guess what? I'm talking to you. And 28, where are you? 28, get your hand up. You know you need to get right with God. Anybody else? Anybody else? You're going to miss this. You miss this. Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 27. Thank you, Jesus. Woo! Okay, here's what I want you to do. All 27 of you, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, water, Bible, friend. Now, wait a minute. If you're back in the family room, bring your children. All 27 of you, and anybody that should have raised their hand, but you didn't. I want you to get your stuff. Nudge a neighbor. Say, I'll go with you. Get out of your seat. Get in the aisle. Nobody go that way. Nobody leaves yet. Let's get these people up front, and then I'll dismiss you. But everybody that raised your hand, you come right now. Get your stuff and meet me right here in front. You come. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on.
I surrender.
Come on home. Come on home. Oh, they're coming. Give them a hand as they come. Yeah, they're coming. Give them a hand as they come. You come too. Come on. Good to be in church. All of you up front, put a smile on your face. This is absolutely, someday in eternity, you're going to know this is the best moment of your life on the planet. You're going to get to heaven and you're going to say to God, thank God that old geezer told me the truth about Jesus. I don't remember where he is. You'll find me in the noisy section of heaven. And you'll be so happy. It is great. Ahead of you are great things. See this man over here waving at you. His name is Pastor Joel. He loves you. He's going to give you some free information, free literature. First, he's going to pray with you so that you invite Jesus into your heart. You got to invite him in. He's a respectable and honored person. And guess what? He is not someone who will intrude. You need to invite him to come in. He's not a party crasher. He's one who says, come on, here's my life. I want to give it to you. And he'll lead you in a prayer and then give you some great stuff to go along with it. So make a left turn and follow Joel right over this way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.